All right. Good evening. And thank you again, everyone, for joining us tonight on this continuing webinar series sponsored by the Small Business Administration. My name is Kenneth Allen, and I'm one of the co-directors of the Entrepreneurship Center at the Los Angeles Urban League. I'm joined by two of my colleagues, Ty Umo and Daniel Leathers. So we're all pleased that everyone could join us tonight for this great seminar hosted by one of our most auspicious business counselors, Crystal Mitchell. I'm just going to take a quick second and just give people who might be unfamiliar with this program a little bit of background, but it's sponsored by the Small Business Administration out of Washington, and the program itself came out of COVID, and the Small Business Administration's focus on ensuring that small businesses around the country got the kind of financial support they needed to weather the economic impact of COVID. And that initial initiative has morphed into an expansive program where the SBA sponsors resources like Crystal to provide significant amounts of technical assistance and support to small businesses to help you both make sure that you can survive the next storm, but more importantly, to grow your firm. And so today's topic is probably core to that mission of helping expand your firm. Just a quick note and some housekeeping things for everyone. We assume that you're all current clients of the Urban League, but if you're not, and would like to learn more about what the Urban League can provide to you in terms of technical and consulting support, as well as access to capital and contracts, please feel free to send an email to my colleague, Ty Umo, who will put his email address in the chat. And you can, from that path, get onboarded as a client to the Urban League and take advantage of a broader range of services and resources that we can bring to bear for you. So with that, I'm going to just turn the call over to our host, Crystal Mitchell. Just a little bit of background for Crystal, for people who aren't familiar, but she is the CEO of Mitchell Business Solutions. She's a co-director of Recycling Black Dollars and co-host of The Business Zone, her online radio show. Without further ado, I'm going to turn the call over to Crystal, and she'll give you guys a great lecture this evening on bookkeeping and compliance. Crystal, over to you.
All righty. Thank you, guys. Thank you. I'm glad to be here, guys. My area is finance and understanding risk and taxes and insurance and accounting, which is really the cornerstone of your business, mainly because it's the foundation. If the foundation of your business is not solid, then your business is in danger of any type of catastrophe, not just the pandemic. But one of the things that we did see throughout the pandemic was when opportunities presented themselves, such as the PPP loans and grants and so forth, our businesses were not ready for those particular opportunities because they didn't have these things in place. And so one of the things that we, as all of our organizations and all of my colleagues that were business coaches, that's what we did. We just kind of rallied up and made sure that you guys are ready for that. This is the most important thing that needs to take place in our businesses, is being ready, not getting ready, but being ready, because opportunities present themselves and you don't have time to be thinking about it. You need to already be about it, right? So that's what this is about, compliance and just making sure that from the standards of running our business, we need to not be concerned, is our insurance paid, are our taxes paid, how much money are we making, are we in compliance with we owe our compliance with the state and the federal government. We need to already know that those things are in place. Okay, so let us move forward. And as small business owners, we're not the only ones that are not in compliance. I was listening the other day to the falling of Silicon Valley Bank. And one of the reasons is that they weren't in compliance, right? They were taking some shortcuts And as a result, the bank failed, and so we got what we got. And then this week we also had another big bank that failed as well. So even the big giants fall. So you know, if they fall, what will happen to us as little businesses? We don't just fall, we get crushed. So we want to make sure that we're better prepared. So I just want to kick off this presentation with this little trailer here, because I think it sets the tone on understanding money and understanding how it dictates how we run our businesses, how this world runs. So I think this will just run, but let me just make sure.
Money. It's a powerful tool, but it's no accident so many of us are struggling with debt. It's how the whole game was designed.
Americans now owe more in student loans than in auto loans or in credit card debt.
It's a crisis that we have to address.
Credit card companies conduct literally tens of thousands of experiments per year to figure out, how do I make the most money from each person?
Experts suggest to retire comfortably, a middle-class American should save at least $1 million.
I think I might be late to the game learning about this.
In the U.S., because of COVID-19, trading on Robinhood soared.
Let me just clarify. Day trading isn't investing. Day trading actually is gambling.
Why do we keep falling for the same old act?
Human beings are terrible lie detectors. Most of us think we're good lie detectors, and that's why we're often fooled.
And how can we avoid taking the bait?
This is your golden opportunity.
So how many of you really feel you understand how money works within our business? Just give me a show of hands. How many of you feel you really, truly understand how money works?
Well, it's not open.
They can do it. They can do a thumbs up, just a thumbs up, and next to their name using the icons there. Can they do that? Yes, no. Yeah.
We've got one.
We got one hand.
we got a smart group, Crystal.
Okay. All right. Daniel said he understands. Tracy said, nope. In the chat. Nobody understands how money works. Some? Okay. All righty. Y'all do know money makes the world go round, right? Right? A little? Okay. So we're in business? We all in business? Right? We're in business to make money, right? Okay. So we truly do have to know how it works, right? We have to know how it works for us. We have to know how it works for business. We have to know how we can take that and take our business to the next level. If we don't have any idea how it works, then how can we make it work for us, right? How can we create that generational wealth? How can we take our business to the next level? I have a story. First, let me introduce myself, and then I have a story as we jump into the today's objectives. And this is recently from a client that I met with. But as Ken says, I'm a business coach, business owner. I've been in business, and I've been in this financial space for a long time. I've been in even before being a business coach and an accountant bookkeeper, I was in the financial industry when I first came out of college. I decided to go into accounting because I was looking for a recession-proof industry that, while I was doing all the other things that were I was excited about when it came to business, that I could ensure that I could make money. Because sometimes in the financial services business, and you know, it got a little touch and go. So I wanted to make sure I could always pay my bills because I understand how money works. So I wanted to make sure no matter what crises was going on in the world, there was a industry that no matter what that was, there was always a need for that service. So in my case, it was accounting and bookkeeping, because I don't care what the world falls down tomorrow, there's going to be some business out there that's going to need to be able to count their money, the little money that they have left over. And they're going to need somebody to help them out. And as long as there's businesses with employees, they're going to need somebody to process payroll. I have been on many occasions, the president, the CFO, we've been the last people to walk out the door because I had to process their paycheck in order for them to walk out the door. I like it that way. So I always have a skill set that me and the president, the CEO, and the CFO are the last people to walk out the door. So that's why I chose this particular industry. And then I just kind of filled up around the other, with all the other skills that I have. I'm an educator and trainer. I am the co-director of Recycling Black Dollars, which is a nonprofit. Been in this community for 35 years, podcaster, speaker, and former instructor at Mount St. Antonio Community College. I taught bookkeeping and accounting.
I forgot about the balance transfer suggestion that you gave me. Adult, so it came back to me this morning when I was weightlifting.
Adult education.
It's an upselling experience and see what's available.
Program, and I'm a certified adult educator.
Are you using your phone?
Using adult.
No.
Maybe go into your...
Daniel, I think you need to mute, my friend. Okay, so today's objective is we're going to talk about small business insurance 101. We're going to talk about small business taxes 101. We're going to talk about the top tax mistakes that small businesses make. We're going to talk about accounting 101. And then we're going to talk about should you hire someone to do your taxes. And in all of that, I'm going to share with you the accounting tools that one should be incorporating in their businesses. But before I do that, recently I met with a client and they've been in business for a number, couple of decades. And they're a husband and wife team. And this is why it's so important for you to have an accounting system and or some sort of automated accounting system, and that all bodies that are in the business understand what your business, what the capability of your business has in revenue, and also what your current revenues are. So, and also the value of your inventory that you have on hand. So I was asking this particular, they were new clients to me. And so I was just kind of getting an overview of where they are, where they wanted to go, what their mid goals were, and what their future goals were. So I asked the husband, what his future goals were, and objectives, and he gave me his idea. He was working toward retirement in the next 4 to 5 years, and I asked him what was that retirement number, and he told me his retirement number was $3 million. And I'm looking around their facility. They actually had a brick and mortar, and they were in the manufacturing business. And I looked around the facility. I went, that's interesting. Then I asked her what her future goals were. She was saying she wanted to incorporate and manufacture a new line of products. And she also indicated that she had some other major ideas for the next 10 years that she wanted to incorporate. And then I asked her what her revenue goals were, and she told me $20 million. And I thought, that's a big difference. And then I asked her, what did she think was the value of the inventory that she had on hand right then and there? And she said that she thought their inventory right now was probably somewhere about $5 million. And he thought their inventory was half of that. So that told me that 9 of 1 of them really knew what their inventory was. Why? Because they really did not have a firm hold on their financials. Now, they're a big manufacturing company. So that says a lot. So, I mean, a lot of us here are still small businesses, but this is a huge manufacturing company that's been in business for a number of years. They are very good at what they do, right? But they did not, they do not have a firm hold on their finances. We have to have a firm hold on that, no matter what level of business we are operating at, right? And if we're partners, everybody got to be on the same page, because we got to work toward a common goal, right? Because we can't be pulling somebody up, but we cannot be pulling. If I got a big dream, I can't be pulling somebody with a small dream. Somewhere we got to meet in the middle. And then the way we meet in the middle is we have our financial reports that help us get there. Okay. So if you guys can put it in the chat for me, I would really appreciate it if you tell me what your businesses are. So as I go along, I have some kind of idea and I can drop some great little nuggets in the chat. I mean, I can drop some nuggets throughout this presentation. So give me an idea of what you're in: retail, bakery, vegan, navigation, retail, catering, real estate and investment, market research, okay, media company, apparel, barbershop. Okay, consulting media company. Okay, and this is what, there's 26 people here. 4 of us are our panelists. Crochet, accessories, okay. Gourmet snacks. Veget is a clothing retail and affiliate marketing. Okay, Ava. Apparel, manufacturing. Okay, granola company and consulting and all natural mosquito repellent. I like that. That's new tech. Okay. All righty. What kind of property management? What kind of aspirations do we have? Small, medium, large type of businesses. Like, what kind of businesses do we want to grow? Super large. How many employees we want? Medium. Medium to large. 5 to 10. 3. Small. Okay. Small. 9 to 10. Okay. Gradually evolve to large, 5 to 8, 6 to 12. Okay. All righty. 15 to 20. I like that, Val. 7 to 10, no cap for Laura. Okay. Because here's the deal, guys. We all have to start thinking that we want to work on a business, not work in a business. What do you think that it takes to work in a business? Anybody got any ideas? Work smart. What else does it take to work on a business, not in the business? Delegation, good word. Good planning. More than one person working at the helm, automation, dedication, passive income generators. But it cannot be 3 to 5 employees, because then that means you're one of those 3 employees, right? We need you to be the president. We need them to be the employees. So that's the way we need to be thinking about our business. So if we're going to have those 5 to 10 to 15 to 20 employees, then we need to make sure we have a solid, solid, solid foundation that can weather time, that we can grow our businesses, because we can't grow our businesses with a very small number of individuals unless we're doing some amazing online passive income generation monetization of our business. And even then it does take more than one person to do that. So let's talk about risk management first, and then we're going to kind of grow into that, because now that's what we're talking about. Now we're talking about risk management. One of the things that I have noticed when I am coaching, and as I with my podcast, I am meeting and greeting and interviewing new businesses. And with some of my podcasts, I have people coming on and we're talking about some amazing subjects lately. And some of those subjects are that, much to my surmise, is that Black folks are on the bottom of the list of every chart that there is out there. And so my thing is we need to get ourselves off the bottom, at least somewhere in the middle. And the only way we can do that is to start thinking differently, thinking bigger, and changing our mindset and generating more revenue, creating businesses that we can work on and not in. But we need to make sure that our businesses are business ready and contract ready. That's how we get there. So let's first talk about business risk, making sure that we know that uncertainty exists no matter what happens. We just, in 2020, that was a huge uncertainty, right? We had no idea it was coming. We had no idea it was going to shut down everything. We had no idea. We were not ready. We were not prepared. Majority of the businesses did not have set asides. We didn't have emergency funds. Thank God the government came along with a PPP grant and some PPP monies and some all that, whatever they did, because if not, we all would have been part of that 400 and something thousand businesses that was shuttered. And hopefully we have learned that we have to be ready, right? So uncertainties which exist regardless of the occurrence of some undesirable and unfavorable event is bound to happen no matter what, right? The possibilities of that happening in the future is probably more so than not. If you look around the country, you see it happening every single day. Right now, it's all been about the weather. If you look on the East Coast, there are tornadoes and hurricanes and floods and businesses going underwater and all kinds of craziness is going on. So you have to be prepared. So there are two types of risks that take place, the internal and the external. You don't know where it's going to come from. You just have to be prepared for it. So let's look at some of those risks that take place. So you have the internal risk. That's damage to your property, firm, or employees. Got to be prepared. Inefficiency on part of the management, right? Because something can happen to those people that you've employed that you have not vetted the proper way. We can see that happening in the world. I use things and catastrophes and things that are on the news as lessons learned. I go, I wonder if they had taken that into account, if they could have avoided that catastrophe, right? Because, or if they had nipped that in the bud, or they had to squash that person before that person got out of hand, right? Injuries from accidents, dishonesty, labor strikes, theft, misbehavior from employees, poor internal organization structure. These are things that are internal risks. And in some cases, you can circumvent this drama before it actually can disrail or derail your business, right? You're the chief in charge, right? So that's your job. Right? Not theirs. That's your job. So you have to be able to cut it off at the knees before it destroy your business, right? Some external risks, some things that you may not have control over, is damage to factories by natural causes, floods, earthquakes, pandemics. That won't be the last pandemic. That won't be the last natural disaster. These things are going to happen, so you have to be prepared for it. In some cases, floods and earthquakes, there may be some insurance, some other risks that could be in place, but you got to be ready for it. impact on your business by adverse legislative change. How do we prevent that? Well, we stay on top of our industry, right? And we are flexible. We are ready to pivot at a given time. We're not so married to our ideas that we can't be flexible, right? A lot of people closed businesses were shuttered because they refused to change, right? Change in technology. There are still people that I know today that are just completely resistant to doing anything on Zoom. They just refuse. I'm not doing it. I'm not going to be on social media. I'm not. Okay, then don't. Because as a business, you're not going to survive. This is where we are. This is the new norm, right? There are businesses that, hey, we're not doing remote. Okay, don't do remote. You're going to have to come up with some form of hybrid because that's the new norm. That's the way we are. So you got to learn how to go with the flow. Got to be flexible because I know as long as I've been in business, I didn't change me 4 or 5 times. I'm probably in version 15 by now. So you have to learn to be flexible. Making sure your business is protected, getting business protection, choosing the right business structure, not just a structure that someone told you about, but making sure it's the structure that's right for you, right? That's really, really important. I ask a lot of people come to me and go, okay, somebody told me to go get an LLC. And I say, why? I don't know. And they, some of them got it before they were even ready for it. And then come January, they have to pay their $800. And then they're like, oh my God, where did that come from? Well, who told you to do the LLC before you made your first dime? Well, they told me I had to have it, but did you ask them why? Did you talk to an attorney? Well, no, that would have cost me money. Well, now it is going to cost you money because you didn't ask, right? So if you don't ask, you don't inquire, you don't research, it's going to cost you money anyway. It's probably going to cost you more money than it would have cost you if you had just did your research in the beginning. So being really, really sure that this is the right structure for you. So your team, having a team, and we're going to talk about that a little later on. So making sure you're choosing the right business structure for you. If you're, I always tell as a basics, not the gospel, just the basic platform. If you're in food, if you're feeding people, you're tending to seniors and older people, you're dealing with children, and you're dealing with pet, then you do need to be in some either an LLC or an S corp, not a sole prop, because those little areas are a very vulnerable grouping of people that people will sue you for, right? So that's a base. And from there, you need to understand, okay, beyond the protection of my personal property from lawsuits, what are the tax implications for me choosing that particular structure? So you want to make sure you understand all the nuances of it, right? Can't say I'm not sure and I don't understand. If we're going to be in business, we have to kind of understand, right? Because that's the purpose of being a business owner. We got to understand. So there are plenty of people out there that can help us. So the more knowledgeable are, the better business owner we're going to be. What are the four areas that need, what are the four areas that need an LLC and a C corp? If you're dealing with children, pets, seniors, and food, consumables, older people, children, and pets. You're welcome. All right. Next, we're going to talk about business insurance. So business insurance protects you from unexpected costs of running a business, accidents, natural disasters, lawsuits that could literally run you out of business if you're not protected with the right insurance. Business insurance can fill in the gaps to make sure both your personal asset and your business assets are fully protected from unexpected catastrophes. And in some instances, you might be legally required to purchase certain types. So depending on the industry you're in, certain professions, like if you're in the real estate industry, for those of us that are consultants, we have to have general liability insurance. Some of us have to have errors and omissions insurance if we're in the financial industry, that we're quoting information or making disclaimers and things like that. If you're an attorney, doctors, they have to have malpractice insurance. So some of those entities require by the federal government that you have to have certain types of insurance. But for your average business owner, business general liability insurance, and we're going to go into more detail, the federal government requires every business within employees to have workers' comp insurance, unemployment, and disability insurance. Some states also require additional insurance. Laws requiring insurance vary by state, so your state website, so you should be visiting your state website to find out the requirements for your business, right? Being in business is not something to take. We have to take light. We should take lightly. We should be really our we should be investigating and researching everything, because it's not something we take lightly, right? Because it could actually change our lives drastically. And if it's more than just us and we have family and we have asset, it could really change your life. So 7 kinds of insurance, general liability. So this is the insurance that protects against financial loss as a result of bodily injury, property damage, and lawsuits, general liability, right? And it doesn't cost as much as you guys think. $1 million coverage is probably less than you spend for a burger if you go out twice a week in a month. Really, it isn't. Very cheap. Much cheaper than somebody suing you. Trust me. Property liability insurance. This is businesses that manufacture, wholesale, distribute, and retail a product. Protects against financial loss against defective products that may cause injury or bodily harm. Again, probably cheaper than you think, and definitely cheaper than somebody suing you. Professional liability insurance, businesses that provide services to customers, protect against financial loss as a result of malpractice, errors, or negligence. Professional insurance. Commercial property insurance, businesses with significant amount of property and physical assets, protects your business against loss and damage of company property due to external risks such as fires, smoke, wind, civil disobedience, or vandalism, right? After you purchase insurance that's required by law, you can find insurance coverages to cover other types of business risks. So you want to ask questions, be very detailed. As a general rule, you should insure against things that you wouldn't be able to pay for on your own. Right? General liability insurance, this coverage protects you against the loss from not just the bodily harm, but it also property damage, medical insurance, libel, slander, defending lawsuits, and settlement bonds or judgments, right? People can perceive something you said and take it the wrong way and decide to sue you. You just don't know nowadays. People are very temperamental right now. Ava said, can you suggest some good insurance companies with a low monthly fee for sole proprietors? You can give me a call, Ava, and I can. I know I use one that's pretty reasonable. There's a couple others out there. There's State Farm, there's Next Insurance. There's quite a few of them out there that are pretty reasonable. but definitely well worth it. And in some cases, I've had some business owners have turned down opportunities because the opportunities required a general liability insurance. And I thought to myself, wow, you turn down an opportunity that can probably increase your revenues probably about 20% because you don't want to spend the money that it costs you to acquire general liability insurance. Mm. So we got to think, we got to change the mindset, guys, right? Change the mindset, because we cannot turn down opportunities to change how we change our economic statuses for our households, for our families, for our communities, because we think that something, we got to pay for something. I had a client tell me recently, after they did their taxes, they said to me, wow, I almost had to pay taxes this year. And I went, that's interesting. I said, can you explain that to me? She goes, I almost had to pay taxes. I said, so that means, are you saying to me, if you had made X amount of dollars, then you would have been upset that you had paid taxes? And, or are you saying to me, you're going to keep how much money you make under a certain threshold to avoid paying taxes? I need to have some clarity on that because I'm not understanding. Because the goal is in business is to make profit. That's why we're in business, to make money. The strategy is to make sure we have business deductions that will reduce our tax liability, unless we're trying to acquire to grow our business and we're going to need capital at some point, then we're going to then show that we did make enough money, we did pay some taxes, so that when we go to the banker, we can show we did make some money. So it just depends on the mindset, right? Let's change the mindset and let's change how we speak. Because if you're telling me, wow, I almost had to pay taxes, so that means you didn't make enough money. Is that what you didn't want to do? Because why am I coaching you then? Because I'm not coaching you not to make enough money. Because at that point, we just wasted my time. So I'm coaching you to increase your revenues so we can change your economic status, so that you're not doing the same routine stuff in your business and not making enough money to live on. That's what I'm coaching you for. So changing the mindset. Val says, does a policy purchase online by a reputable company versus through an agent matter? I don't think so. I think sometimes agents, depending on how qualified and how educated they are and good at what they do, they can be very beneficial for you because they can make things happen in a quick, in a hurry. You know, if they're professional and that's their business, you know, they get paid by the company. They don't get paid by you. So, you know, if they are selling you the best product that's out there to service you and they're part of your team, because your insurance agent is also part of your team, then it doesn't really matter, right? Just choosing the right person that's there to be part of your team, not just somebody that flies in and sells you a product. But doesn't have a vested interest in your success and your growth, then that's a different story. This agent should be part of your team, just like your CPA, your attorney, your bookkeeper, your whomever, okay? Home-based businesses, insurance. Businesses that run out of the owner's personal home generally add it to the homeowner's insurance as a rider that offers protection of business equipment and liability. And remember, it's operating out of your home, so you truly want this insurance because your home is where you and your family, your children, and your husband live. You don't want someone to sue you and take your home, is where you're running your business, but it's also that's covering your head and keeping you and your family, taking care of you and your family. So No, just because you're at a home-based business, that is not a business. So make sure you're protecting yourself if you're operating a home-based business, and you're, especially if you're producing food, if you have a cottage industry license. Business owner insurance. Most small business owners, especially home-based business owners, don't think about this. Partner insurance. If you have a partner, it's a good idea that you guys have partner insurance. If you are sitting on a board, a nonprofit board, probably a good idea that there's some director's insurance, because I don't know if you guys are aware of this, but if you're sitting on a nonprofit board, guess who's responsible, who's the responsible party, the fiduciary responsible party for that nonprofit? It'd be you. So if something, if there's some improprieties going on at that nonprofit, and a entity like the IRS has to step in, they're going to ask for all board members' information, and they're going to, if they can't get it from the entity, then they're going to come after your assets. So, and if you have a business partner, and something happens, and yes, Ava, and you have a business partner, and you don't have an agreement and some business insurance in place, and that business partner, he or she dies, and they have a spouse that you're not exactly partial to, and you didn't protect yourself, guess what's going to happen? That spouse is not going to become your new business partner. So you want to make sure you take you think about those things, because things happen, right? Errors and omissions. This is for professionals, making sure you protect against claims of inadequate work and negligible actions. Things happen, guys. Not exactly partial to. Yeah, that's the word. Not exactly partial to. Right. There and the mediator, which was the partner, no longer in place. So now you're dealing with that partner that you're not exactly partial to. So just to know these things is important, that you protect yourself. So it's great when we're all warm and fuzzy and we think everything is going to be fine. But things sometimes just are not fine. So be careful of that. And I learned this, and not that something happened, but I had a business partner and was not partial to her mate at all. In fact, didn't like him at all. And we were having major problems. He was on the backside creating major problems. And so finally we had talked to an attorney, and we had to actually get her to sign off that if in something were to happen to her, in lieu of that, we had to get an insurance. We had to get insurance for the three of us. It was three of us. And we had to actually get an agreement to make sure that if something were to happen to her, he would not be a partner. He would have absolutely nothing to do with the business, because that would have been disastrous. So it was a hard conversation, but a necessary conversation, because we were not partial to him at all. So next, your team. Hiring your team, your bookkeeper. On an average, bookkeepers cost. Now I'm gonna a little disclosure here. I've been a bookkeeper for the last 30 years. Of late, I have a different mindset about bookkeeping. In the beginning, when I first started my business, that's what I did. I went out and my clients were small businesses like you guys. And that, you know, that was my marketing. I will be that person for you. I will do your books. Don't worry about it. I will take care of it. But in the latter years, I have decided that I have done them a disservice, because what I found out, and now I do less of that and I do more troubleshooting. And I have found that not all bookkeepers are like myself. I'm more of an educator. So I educate my clients on what it's supposed to look like. And I make sure they sit down and I teach them how to read their reports. I teach them on what I'm doing so that they're very clear. If someone were to ask them a question, they don't have to reach out to me. They can answer that question. But not all of us are created equal like that. And so I've had a lot of new clients that cannot answer a question if they're going to look for capital, they cannot find their bookkeeper, or they have tax questions and they don't have a clue why their bookkeeper did what they did. So now my new mindset is, let me teach you how to do this. Let me show you how your software is supposed to work. So, and let me teach you how the process works. So when you hire that person, you know exactly what they're doing. And so then when you instruct them on what you need, then they can give you exactly what you need and it will not slow up the process. I've met quite a few people that have lost loans because they couldn't track down their bookkeeper and their bookkeeper couldn't get them what they wanted. And they had to call me in to restructure everything and it cost them a lot more money. So I'm of a different mindset now. So I teach you and then I help you find that right person that would be a better person for you. But so that was a little digression there because I think it's important. Bookkeepers are the people that oversee your financial data on a daily, monthly, quarterly basis. On an average, their prices start somewhere, if they're good at what they do, somewhere between $75 and $85 an hour. Now, that can be super expensive or not, because if you know how to do the day-to-day and how to use the system, you probably only need them to come in on once a month or maybe twice a month. And so, and it usually, if they're good, if they know what they're doing, that might be twice a month. They might be $160 a month. And so that is a lot more affordable than you think. So, but that is the rate for a good bookkeeper, $75 to $85 an hour. If anything less than that, that's probably not the best. Okay. Next person on your team. If is your enrolled tax agent, this is that individual that is a IRS certified tax preparer. He has gone through all of the education and gotten his hours, and he has to be certified every year in order to prepare your taxes for you. They differ on various levels of skill and education and expertise. So you can have an enrolled agent, and they usually somewhere between $146 to $273 an hour, depending on your tax status, your corporate status. And it could be a little bit more depending on your corporate status, or a CPA and that tax accountant, and their course is somewhere between $225 to $475 an hour. They usually file taxes as well, but they are also those individuals that can give you tax advice. They can set up your quarterly taxes. They can actually introduce you to investors. If you're looking for investors for your business, they can do valuation of your business. They can help you plan for your future. If you're looking to do contract work, they can help you set up and forecast so that you're better prepared when you go to pitch your business for whatever new opportunities that are out there for you. So that's why they cost so much more. Bookkeepers are more on the average. Some bookkeepers are there to help you grow. Just depends on what their education and their background. Mine's is kind of because I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a business coach slash bookkeeper. accountant, you know, I have a different expertise than a lot of them do. I kind of incorporate all of that together. But, you know, you interview them, you decide who will be, who can help you get to that next level. But tax preparers and tax consultants can professionally prepare your taxes while offering insights into law changes that might affect your business. Some tax accountants also offer tax planning advice to help businesses and individuals save money in taxes. And a career tax accounting is challenging, and it can be quite rewarding. But here's another thing I need to express to you guys. If you go to your tax person and you tell them, I don't want to pay taxes, he or she are going to do exactly that. They're going to make sure that your tax return shows that you didn't make enough money to pay taxes. So now, 5 years down the line, 2 years down the line, you need capital because you need employees or you need some new equipment. You're going to take those great tax returns because you need 3 years of those tax returns. And every year, those tax returns show that you made no money because you didn't want to pay any taxes. And then you're going to get there, and that banker or lender is going to say, wow, you made no money. I'm sorry, you don't qualify for this loan. So think about that. That's why it's good to have a CPA, because you sit down with them and say, hey, I know in 5 years, I want to share with you my vision for my business. And I know in 5 years, this is what I want to do. I want to grow my business. I want to buy the building that my business is housed in, or I want a brick and mortar building, but I don't want to pay rent for it. I want to own the building. So what do I need to do? How much income or profit do I need to make? And what does my tax preparation need to look like so that I am prepared to do that in 5 years from now, right? You sit down and have this conversation, and then they can start to consult with you and prepare you for that, right? Because you're preparing for the future, okay? So that's a better conversation. This is part of your team, and you're preparing for the future. Let's see, this question here. What do you think of tools like Honey App to help with budgeting and invoicing and reports? Awesome. And I believe QuickBooks actually integrates with HoneyBook. A couple of people I know that use the Honey app, and they really like it. Just depends on what type of business you're in. Sally, how does that work when you're considering drop shipping? Far as Nolo books, yeah, Nolo could be good as well. Reference, anything is reference, but Nolo also is, if you actually can talk to a live person, here's what I say for anybody that you guys are going to bring to your team. You can sit down and have a conversation. Usually when I refer people over when people ask me, can you refer someone over that can do my taxes, or I need a CPA, I give you three choices. And I give you three choices for three reasons. For one reason, I want you to call them, and I want you to interview them to make sure that you guys are on the same page, that you guys are in line with each other toward your vision. Then you choose the person that's going to be the best fit for your vision to be on your team. And then you guys work it that way. Unfortunately, when you use those online platforms, they are online. They're great resources and references, but they're not live people. You can't pick up the phone and ask them a live question when you have live concerns, right? People can call Crystal for a live concern or text me or schedule an appointment, and then I can refer you to the right place. And you got to have a referral source, but live people on your team is a good thing to have, right? So just keep that in mind. It's y'all's decision. Sonia says, I have another appointment. This is wonderful. I wish I could stay. Would it be possible to get a recording? Ty, Ken, Daniel, is that possible for them to get a recording?
Hi, yes, good evening, everyone. The webinars are recorded. And so if you email Ty Umo, ty.umoh@laul.org, he can work to get you access to the recorded videos. Thank you, everyone.
All righty. Okay. All right, next. What are the business taxes? So business taxes, very important because you got to be in compliance, right? So business taxes, income tax, everybody know what that is. Everybody, since you've been probably 14, 15 years old, you've been filing your business taxes. So this is the thing at the end of the every year. It's an obligation that we always have based upon whatever your tax life, your tax rates are. There's business tax, there's taxes, in personal income taxes. Do you need bookkeeping when you use websites? Yes. Anytime you're running, making money, you still have to do your bookkeeping. Yeah. It Shopify actually syncs in with QuickBooks or Wave. Estimated taxes. When you make over a certain amount of money, well, actually, when you make over a certain amount of money and you actually owe a certain amount of money, so let's say you owe the IRS over $1,200 at the end of the year, at that point in time, you need to sit down with your tax person, your CPA, and you need to be paying estimated taxes if you're solely working for yourself and you're not having any taxes taken out of any of your income, that you, everything you receive is without any taxes. Estimated taxes are for those freelancers, small business owners, and independent contractors that fit that criteria. And you are receiving 1099 NECs, then you need to sit down with your tax person to talk about being required to pay quarterly taxes. So you would do this with your tax person. Business license tax, that's something that the state of California, the city of Los Angeles, if you're doing business in the city of Los Angeles, is the BTRC. They're adamant about this. And so you register for it. And the taxes are due February 19th, and you need to pay those or you get this huge penalty if you don't file it by that February 19th. You put that on your calendar and you make sure you do that. Payroll taxes, you know, if you're an employer, and there's payroll taxes, we all know what that is. We've all had that withdrawn from our payroll checks. Self-employment tax. This is the money, that $800 that people pay when you have your LLCs and your S-Corps. You're paying a self-employment tax. That people say, I don't want to pay that to the state of California. You're not paying that to the state of California. You are actually paying into fund your Medicare and your Social Security. So when you retire, you can then apply at 65, not at retirement. When you're at 65, you can apply for your Medicare and Social Security. It is a imposed tax for the small business owner. It is very similar to your FICA that is deducted from your payroll check. I think I must have answered that question 5 times this year. So it is not anything you're giving to the state of California. You are taking care of yourself. Or if not, you won't have that when you turn 65. So personal income tax, we kind of know that. If you're single, you're filing, you're filing a return if it's over $12,200. It's based upon your revenue, and there's a chart, and there's late fees. If you don't, everybody in America is required to file their taxes. So you're either, and if you have deductions, fantastic, because you can apply your deductions. And if you're like the wealthy, you've learned some amazing tricks and to the trade on how to reduce that. Estimated payroll taxes, as I just said, these are installments. They're due April 15th, June 15th, September 15th, and then the following for the current year, they're due January 15th. So this is you will sit down with your CPA or your tax person, and they will set that up for you so that you will be paying into the system. So let me ask this question. How many of you are just completely overwhelmed when it comes to tax season? Y'all can put that in the chat. Just a little question to break up the monotony here. Yeah, I know it's a hard one, right? So I'm usually on the other side. My own taxes is no big deal, but I tell you, y'all like to wore me out this year. I was so glad they pushed the taxes back to October 19th. I was glad for all the tornadoes and the hurricanes and the storms and all that sort of stuff. That was the only thing to get you guys to calm down. Everybody was crazy. So so now everybody's been given a reprieve. That you don't have to worry about it. So I guess the drama will start back up in September. But you guys got to have a whole 4 months to get your tax situation together. So don't come back crazy in September, because by October 15th, you got to file your taxes if you haven't done so already. You should already have this stuff together. Okay. So the self-employment tax, this is that $800 that you're paying if you haven't, if you're not having this deducted somewhere else. But this is paying toward your Social Security, your Medicare, so that when you turn 65 and you apply for your Social Security and Medicare, it will be there in the till waiting for you. April 15th, tax day, right? So here are some important dates you guys can put down in your little on your calendar. Sometimes this stuff doesn't pop up. So here's the thing. You need to be accountable for it. February 28th, your business register, oh, the 28th, not the 19th, the business registration tax cert, 28th. The city of Los Angeles is unmerciful, guys. So make sure you put that on your calendar. You can do that online at the city business portal. March 15th, your IRS 1065 Schedule K-1 for partnerships and multi-member LLCs are due. Your IRS 1120s and Schedule Ks for your S-Corps are due. April 15th, normally, unless something weird like this year happens, is for your sole proprietors and LLCs. Estimated quarterly tax payments are due. Your IRS 1120s and Schedule Ks for your C-Corps are due. May 15th to June 15th, your quarterly taxes estimated quarterly taxes are due June 15th. So we got next week, some quarterly taxes are due. Nonprofit 990s and 199Ns are due. Now here's the thing. Everybody in the state of California got pushed back, except for three counties, but which were Modesto and three others, Cascade, I think. So everybody's been pushed back. Possibly if before that announcement came out, your tax person may have did an extension for you, but on a norm, your 990s and your 199Ns are due. So you want to check with your tax preparers, or if you have nonprofits, to make sure that applies to that, or that they filed an extension just in case. But generally, right now, everybody has got that October date. October 15th is actually the date. September 15th, you needed more time. So everybody right now should be on that extension to the 15th. And on the September 15th, the partnerships and S-Corps. But again, everybody's been extended to this year for October 15th for sole props, C-Corps, and LLCs. And then the 4868 sole props and S-Corps and 7004 partnerships are due. So that's your calendar. Take a picture of that. Unless something else comes up, that's the calendar that is like that every single year. Okay. I don't know is not usually a good answer for the IRS. They don't really care for excuses unless there's been a catastrophe. Again, that's the quarterlies that are due. Payroll taxes, if you guys are doing taxes, payroll, but quarterlies. Business rates for C Corps this year, 2020, actually is they're the same right now. 21% for corporations, excuse me, and for sole props and S Corps are considered pass-through entities, and their income tax are taxed at owner personal rates, which is somewhere between 10% and 37%. So you should check with your tax preparer or your CPA. Property taxes, income tax and property tax. So if your income tax is somewhere like 0.73%, if you sell things or collecting, you're responsible collecting sales tax, as we all know. And you can find all of this lovely information on the business portal for Los Angeles. And then if you're in the county, you can go to the county site. All that information is out there and available to you. You just need to reach out and go to your, use Google, and it can help you find anything that you are looking for. So Ebony asked a question, is the business registration for sole prop? Yes, the city of Los Angeles says if you're in the city of Los Angeles, everybody has to register, but not everybody, except for insurance agents. Insurance agents don't have to register. But if you don't, if you make under a certain, I think it's $50,000, you register, but you won't have to pay anything. Okay, but you do have to register. Okay, and if you're in the outlying areas, Culver City, Santa Monica, they also require you to register on their city pages. But if you live in Los Angeles and you're doing business in those areas, you still have to report what you're doing in those areas as well. So go over to the city of Los Angeles to the business portal, take a look around. Find out what you're required to do. Business Los Angeles didn't used to be quite as gangster about that, but they have gotten to be quite gangster about that. So you really need to take a look at that and make sure you're staying on top of that. Okay. All right. All right. So let's talk about the five top tax mistakes small businesses make. One. Failing to file, sending the proper forms or payments. So depending on the legal structure of your business, the type of industry you're in, or whether or not you have employees, you're required to file and send any number of different forms to the IRS and possibly your state tax department. Some have to file quarterly, such as payroll taxes, estimated income taxes, and sales taxes. Others are submitted annually. Still others, such as W-2s and 1099s, must be sent directly to your employer and other workers you're paid throughout the year so they can file their taxes. To file their taxes. So just to be on the safe side, you can have your accountant set up an annual calendar so you know what's due and when. The IRS publishes a tax calendar each year listing the due dates for business and individuals. Now, I personally think if you are doing payroll taxes, the best thing to do for payroll taxes is to let a company do your payroll taxes for you. You don't have to worry about when anything is due. So QuickBooks does payroll, Wave does payroll, Gusto does payroll, ADP does payroll, Paychex does payroll. It is worth every dime you pay them to let them worry about all those dates, as opposed to you, the business owner, trying to keep up with all those dates. Just something that I have observed over the years being in business. I don't do payroll for people. I set it up on QuickBooks and I process it through that, but I don't do manual payroll for anyone because IRS is relentless when it comes to employees and they payroll, okay? So, but failing to file the proper forms, because you're not in their business. That's not your business. So why even bother? Pay the people that's in business to do that. That's my advice. Number two, overestimating or underestimating or overreporting or underreporting. Little story here. I had a client years and years ago that was a referral to me from actually my bank. This client and I had the same bank, and the bank director came over to me and asked me, could I help this guy? So what had happened once I went and met with him, what I found out was he was in the property business, property management, or he was buying property. When he would go to buy property, he would estimate the value, the rent that he would be in, his buildings would generate. And that was his number. Well, he wasn't maintaining any books anywhere. So he did have his rent rolls, but it wasn't in a system. So he couldn't run a report. So when he went to his tax person, which happens a lot, he just gave him an estimate. Well, he over-reported his income. So of course, when he over-reported his income, he was taxed on that over-reporting of that income. So he owed $20,000 in taxes, and it was causing all kinds of havoc. So when I actually was called in and I had to go in and do an analysis, and had to go through all his rent rolls he had like five or six buildings, and I had to go through each one of the buildings and calculate the rent, I found out that some of the apartments were vacant and had been for a minute. Some of them had, because some of them were under Section 8, so some of them were not, there's a word, I can't remember what it is. Monica, you're on, I think, so you know what that is. There's a where they haven't sanctioned it to be rented. There's a word that they use. I can't think of it, what it is right now. So it wasn't being rented. And so when I calculated all the vacancies, and we were able to reduce that amount that he really wasn't really getting any income from, in fact, he was taking a loss, they owed him money. But it took us about 3 years to clean that up. And so they had to redo his taxes in order to do that. So over-reporting is disastrous. That's why you want an accounting system. So, and of course, underestimating can create all kinds of penalties for you. So having an accounting system will prevent you from having to overpay or avoid penalties for underpaying. So those are some of the mistakes people make. Number three is, and this one is big, and I am sure some of you guys, if I asked you to raise your hand, some of you may be guilty of this, mixing business and pleasure, your personal with your business, commingling your muddling those financial waters by intermingling your personal and your business expenses can create big messes that will have to be cleaned up when tax time rolls around. So separating your business and your personal by maintaining and keeping separate bank accounts and separate credit card accounts, keeping receipts separate, keep paying yourself a salary instead of a draw directly from your bank account. These are areas that your bookkeeper should be advising you on. This really just makes life so much easier. So keep the two separate. Pay yourself a salary, which is good for you anyway. Taking money from your business account and putting it in your bank account with no documentation. Sharing account, as I said, personal and business. Depositing checks, sign for the business account into your personal account, and vice versa. Just a mess. And if you ever get audited, oh my God, you and the auditor are going to be battling. So just make it separate. Take an account for your business, take an account for your personal. Keep the two worlds separate. Keep them separate, guys. Makes it so much easier. Poor record keeping. You have to keep good records. Well-organized records make it easier to prepare your taxes. Documentation, both the amount should answer and provide any question the IRS may have. When you don't have that and you leave area open for speculation and questions and for you to get nervous, then things get all kind of crazy with them. It extends out the audit process. So if you can answer them quickly, you can provide them with what they need without being a little OCD. You don't have to be OCD. Just make sure that you keep good records. How long should you keep records? Tax records probably should be kept for about 10 years. Tax receipts and things like that. You now can digitize those things. So you can actually scan those documents, put them in a Google Drive so that you have accessibility to them, but then destroy the records after that. You know, of course, hospital records and things like that, maybe 7 to 10 years. Credit card records, again, everything is online now. So if you take those and put them in a Google Drive and you won't have to keep all that paper around in case of a fire or a flood or what have you. Nowadays, we're all kind of digitized anyhow. Even if you're keeping them on a flash drive, you can't find the flash drive. So I say use online platforms. I don't think they're going anywhere. Or just keep a flash drive and throw it into a safe deposit box and keep one of those on hand so that you're not keeping it. But documentation is really good so that it will address any issues. If you're keeping QuickBooks, all your records are there as long as you're paying for your subscription. Number five, not taking your proper deductions. So startup costs, interest, tax interest, fees, charitable contributions, retirement plan contributions, bad debt, loss. If you're losing money and didn't make any money, I know a lot of you during the pandemic lost money. Those are deductions, guys. Your home office, your insurance, your utilities, your property taxes, your home repair, if you're sharing a certain part of your home with your office, and most of us, a lot of us nowadays do have remote home offices. So these are tax deductibles, and you can have this conversation with your tax person. Health insurance, education and training, the betterment of yourself. I have a lot of people that refuse to go to workshops and classes because they think it costs you money. It's a deduction, guys. It's a deduction. Deductions reduce your tax liability. You make as much money as you want, but it's deductions, okay? So those are the five mistakes that most business owners make. So now let's talk about how do you keep track of all this stuff? Well, we do this through accounting systems. So we track, one, we open that bank account, keeping our personal and our business separate. We track our income and our expenses. We develop and we understand how a bookkeeping system works. And then once we understand it, then we can hire someone that can run it for us, right? Let's go back to the bank account for a real quick minute. Opening a bank account that is legally registered for your business is really good, especially when you're looking to grow your business and do contract business. They're looking for you to have not your personal account, but an actual business account. You need so that you can keep this separate from your personal account. You can always pay yourself. You also want to protect your personal assets in the unfortunate case of bankruptcy, lawsuits, and audits. If you're separate, then it won't bleed over into your personal. You want to make sure that you have a separation between yourself. Even as a sole proprietor, not required, but definitely highly recommended. Make sure you get a business. look to building your business credit. So one of those goals that you should have is being able to apply for a business credit card. And you might have to start small, maybe a Staples or somewhere like that. Make sure you're paying that on time because business credit is important. And because that's how you establish your business credit is starting small, separating your business credit from your personal credit, and then getting to a place where you and the business are completely separate. You're not even using your personal credit to validate your business credit. Because if you have an LLC is a separate entity from you. You work for the LLC. If I was an employee, I wouldn't have to validate my company's credit. So even as the CEO, so that's your goal. So keeping separate, making sure you don't commingle stuff, okay? So building business credit, important. Determining how you're gonna get paid. You guys, we don't work for free. We need to be able to establish how much money we're gonna make so that we can make sure we're getting paid. We should not be working for free. Establish your sales tax procedure. Really be clear on that. I have a lot of clients that's not real clear on that, but I will tell you this, the Board of Equalization or whatever they're called now, the sales tax and whatever, you can go and make an appointment with them and they will make sure you're real clear on how you should pay that. Determine what your tax obligation is, making sure you understand, they understand, so that you don't default in anywhere. I don't know, it's not a good explanation, okay? So get as much information as you need. This kind of information doesn't really change. So once you spend that time getting that information, you don't have to like do this every year, right? Then understand a payroll system, what that will look like before you get to that place, especially if you have aspirations to do contract do corporate and contract and governmental contracts. Understand what that looks like. Find that company, whether it's with QuickBooks or whomever you're going to do that with. 9 steps for building corporate credit. Put your business on the map. Maintain good credit with your suppliers and vendors. Make sure your business has its own EIN, which is their employer identification number. Pay bills on time all the time. Establish your Dun & Bradstreet. Open a business credit card. Get incorporated when that time comes. Separate. You see how many times I didn't repeat it this. Separate business and personal. Can't tell you that enough. And then monitor your credit to make sure it's going to do. We're always planning 2, 3, 4, 5 years down the line because we want to grow our business. We are learning how to work on the business, not in the business. So it takes a mindset shift that we're not the employee, we're their employer, we're the owner of the business, and we're setting the business up to scale it to be a big business, and hoping you guys have big business plans and visions for that business. Periods of limitations, owe additional taxes situation. Let's see, what do we want to do? If you owe additional tax in situations, it's 3 years, it's the limit of statutation. 6 years if you do not report income and more than 25% of your gross income. File a fraudulent return. It is no limit. There is no limit, a statute of limitation. Do not file a tax return. No statute of limitation. File a claim for credit or refund 3 years, 2 years after the period, and file a claim of loss on worthless securities and bad debt 7 years. So that is that. Now let's talk a little bit about this part, QuickBooks and Wave. So these are the business tools. So on an average, QuickBooks is somewhere between $25 and $80. It has a product base for you to manage your financials. This is the tool. It is an excellent system. that will manage your the income and manage the outgo, money coming in, money going out. The week before, if you guys were here when I talked about cash flow, this is how you manage your cash flow. Seeing how your money coming in, seeing how your money is going out, and making sure you're staying on top of how that money's coming in, going out, right? And keeping your bills paid on time, and staying on top of your accounts receivable, who your vendors are, all of those things. That is how you keep your cash flow in line, is through an accounting system. So I recommend QuickBooks for certain entities. If you have, if you've been in business and you have, you're generating revenue, QuickBooks is a great product. If you're just starting out your business, Wave is a great product as well. It's more user-friendly for that small business owner who doesn't have a lot of resources, just starting out, not really making any money just yet. So Wave is an absolutely free product. Both of them are very user-friendly. They are automated with bank feeds, so it syncs to your bank account, makes it very easy for you to use. I'm going to finish up this presentation, and I'm going to just walk you through it so you guys can see what it looks like. And while I'm doing that, I would like to know who is using QuickBooks or some accounting system, whether it's like QuickBooks or Wave right now. You can guys can put that in the chat. I'm going to skip by this because we've already kind of talked about this. And I'm not even going to ask you guys who you should do your own taxes, because I'm going to say that you guys should at this point, if you're in business. So we got some Waves using Excel and Wave. QuickBooks. Okay. QuickBooks. Look at that. QuickBooks. All righty. All right. Look at that. All righty. So some business resources there is the City of Los Angeles Business Portal, the State of California Business Portal, the IRS Business Portal, where that you can get the calendar and stay on top of things. So I say at the beginning of the year, jump on over to the IRS to find out what the calendars are so that you know what's going on, so you are better prepared as to what's happening. For my new business owners out there, sometimes money's a little tight. And if you're making less than $55,000 a year, you may qualify for free tax filing with an IRS certified tax preparer through the county. So it's free tax preparing. It's called VITA, actually. So you can go on over there. You guys will get a recording of this, and you can go over there. It's free tax prep for Los Angeles, and if you made less than $55,000 last year, so since there's been an extension to October, if you haven't done your taxes, then you can use them to help you out to get your taxes done. So this is my contact information, guys. I also do consulting for the Los Angeles Urban League. So if you have questions on your accounting, then you can always set up an appointment with me, and I can look at your books if you have questions there. Or if you need to set up QuickBooks or a Wave, I can also help you with that. So there's a couple questions, Ava. So self-employment taxes for self-employed, single member, however, S-Corps for LLCs and should be self-employment taxes as well. Yeah, everybody gets that $800 at the beginning of the year. So that's... Yeah. And then what is important? What is the importance of the Dun & Bradstreet? The Dun & Bradstreet is the monitoring system for business credit. And the best thing about the Dun & Bradstreet, unlike the ones for your personal credit, you get to set it up. You get to set up your vendors, and then they monitor your vendors. And long as you're paying those vendors on time, then it's setting up is setting up your credit profile for them. So Brennan, there's a free version, and then there's a paid version of the Dun & Bradstreet. But you get a profile, you get a credit profile with Dun & Bradstreet. So everybody should be setting that up.
Hi, Crystal, it's Ken. I just wanted to maybe add, throw another question on top of that. Okay. Is there a particular time in a business's existence when they should ensure that they have a Dun & Bradstreet profile?
I think if they've been in business more than 2 years and they're making money, yes, they should do it now if they don't have one.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If they've been filing taxes and actually operating as a business and called and not a gig, then let me clarify that, Ken. Let me backtrack a little bit. If they really consider themselves a business and not a gig and a side hustle.
In today's world, everybody's got a side hustle, right?
Yeah, if it's not their side hustle and it's really truly a business and we're really trying to grow it and we're looking for contracts and opportunities on that level, you definitely need to set up your Dun & Bradstreet. How about that?
Perfect.
Because some of us do have side hustles. And ain't nothing wrong with the side hustle.
Absolutely. You know, I think, I'm not sure if you had a chance to address Val Banks' question that's in the Q&A from 542.
Let me see. Does a policy purchase by a replicant? Yeah, I did talk about that. So I think, you know, insurance agents are great because here's the thing, as you're growing and there might be some bundled packages that you would not know about if you didn't have an agent. So if it was a reputable agent that was part of your team per se, then I would say yes. That you could have an agent that's there for you, especially if you have aspirations to grow your business. They get paid like insurance agents. They get paid by the company, not by the customer itself. Did that answer your question, Val? Okay. All right. So let's run real quick over here to QuickBooks. Let me bring that over here. Let me reduce this. So for those of you that don't have QuickBooks, pick that over here. I do have to open this up right here. All righty. Just so we can get a little run through over here with the QuickBooks. And I'm just really gonna show you far as what this looks like when we wanna look at, cause a lot of you appear to be using QuickBooks. And so what I want to look at is more the how you can use it to better forecast for your business. Because I think that's important when we run financials. When we use the tools that it has for us, when we're looking at our cash flow, and we talked about this for those of you that were here for the cash flow class that I did. So you actually can see the cash flow, you can see the money coming in, you can see which what your net changes are. You can see the money going out. You can see that you obviously needed more money coming in. This is a sample company. So of course, you know, starting January, we're in May. If this was a real company, you can see this was a very slow month, which is usually what happens. Understanding what your slow months are. Money going out, money coming in, when things start to pick up, but being able to adjust your cash flow. Bill.com, similar to QuickBooks, I've been paying my clients through Bill.com and considering using their invoicing. So actually, QuickBooks actually integrates with Bill.com, where you can pay your bills through QuickBooks, through Bill.com. Invoice your everything is under the one umbrella. So when you go to run your profit and loss statement, your report, it will give you a report. Let's make sure that I close down some stuff so this will populate faster. And when you run a report, you're getting everything in one place, Ebony, as opposed to having to pull the report from bill.com on what was paid and making sure your P&L is going to generate so that you see all the expenses being populated here on this report, as well as all of the income, so you have a better feel of what your business is doing. Because if bill.com will issue a report, but the resources that you have in QuickBooks is far more extensive than what you're going to get in bill.com. But you can actually pay your bills with bill.com. Let me show you how that works. So you put your bills in. If you wanted to add a bill here, create a bill. Let me see if I just created a bill. We're going to say telephone. Telephone bill, schedule a payment. And as you can see right here, pay any vendor with a bank transfer. And it does the same thing. It charges you for it. You can save it. And then you can schedule bill pay, which is bill.com. It actually is a integration with QuickBooks. And then you can pay it through your card, or for free, you can pay it. It will do an ACH at no cost, and it will set it up. You just have to set up the, incorporate your bill.com with QuickBooks, and it'll all work with under that same umbrella. Okay? And now you're going to get that. So why would you do that? So here's the beauty of using QuickBooks the way it's supposed to, it was designed to use. Just like you get, and I'm trying to close this out right here, but it's going to calculate it anyway. Let's see if that'll stop that. Just like you get an accounts receivable with your invoices to see how much money you have out, and how much how your payments should be coming in. All righty, come on. So let's close that out. Let's start that all over again. You get the same thing with your accounts payable. So when I use QuickBooks for businesses, right? When a bill comes in, I plug in all the bills that need to be paid in a certain period of time. Especially in nonprofits, because nonprofits, their margins are smaller, right? And they're relying on sponsorship in order to get to pay their bills, to manage and support their businesses, right? So they have to know at all costs how much money they need and when they need it. So that means I need to know in advance, 6 months, 6 weeks, 3 weeks, a month in advance, what needs to be paid so that I know how much money needs to be on hand in order to make sure those bills are paid. So QuickBooks allows you to create reports, the accounts receivable report and the account payable report. And then you can see how you can stay on top of your accounts receivable. So when I look at my accounts receivable report, I can look and say, okay, this is how much I have out based upon this. And these are, this is a sample company, so it's not going to tell you a whole lot because this I just use this as a sample. This is how much that is out as of this day. Now just imagine if this was hundreds of thousands of dollars. This is out by 130, 31 to 60, up to 90, then, and over 90, then I would know how to proceed. So that's my age receivable. So if I go back to my accounts payable, based upon what that outstanding would be, then I would know how to navigate in order to make sure that my bills were paid on time. And the reason that I want to make sure my bills are paid on time is because I want to make sure that I'm consciously aware that I'm building my company credit, and I want to make sure that I'm not jeopardizing my company credit. That makes sense to everyone? So my accounts receivable report is the same thing. So based upon this, I know putting my bills in every time they come in, I know exactly what I have to pay during those same quarters, and I can manage that. So you actually can sync up, and bill pay might be in here. So let's see, billpay.com. I think it is. It may be in here. I think that is billpay.com. I think that's what that is. But you can sync those up with QuickBooks. And if it doesn't come in this way, you can actually use Zapier in order to match it up. You can actually link it up to it. QuickBooks is actually, like I said, it's the premier accounting system that can help you make sure that you're on top of every aspect of your business, right? I was teaching, someone called me the other day, and this person has been very resistant about accounting, bookkeeping. And so this yesterday morning, actually, and I finally had got her to that place. She said something that finally I was like, okay, this is my window. I'm going to slam it in right now, because she had been resisting me for the last 3 months. She'd been resisting. I was like, okay, we're going to set up an appointment and we're going to do the training for this. Yeah, okay, okay. Yeah. And every time we meet, we'd be on a different topic. And so finally, the last meeting we had, she says, I asked her a question and she could not answer me. And I was like, okay, next meeting, this is what we're going to do. So we're meeting, we went through it, we had some stumbles. And then when I was taking her through the software yesterday, we were doing Wave. She goes, oh my God, I love this. And that's all I needed to hear. So now she is on track. Every time I actually get somebody that's been resisting me about this, she goes, oh my God, and I can do this, and I can do this, and I can do this. That's what we want. You want to be able to use it as a tool. You want to be able to say, oh my God, I made $10,000. Look how much money I have out there. I need to get it. That's when we're talking about working on our business and not in our business. When we're on top of our business, we're not working diligently and not seeing the results of all the labor that we're doing. So that's why these are so important. This is why we as organizations and business coaches are staying on top of you guys, because it's so important that we change your mindset to get you to work on your business and not to work so feverishly in your business. It will change everything about us as a people and everything about the economics of our community. It will give us so much more power and so much more say-so when we change what we are doing, working on our business, not in our business. And that's my new mantra. Last year, my mantra was creating and generating other revenue streams. Now my mantra is that we got to work on it. Because I tell you guys, I cannot handle looking at another chart. Every time someone comes on my show, the community briefing, and they put up a chart, and Black folks is on the bottom of every single chart. I can't take it. I feel like I'm having a snowflake meltdown. I just can't take it. I just can't take it no more. We got to do better, guys. I know we're capable of doing better, so we got to do better. And I can't do this by myself. The Urban League can't do this by, we can't do this by ourselves. We need y'all, right? So we're giving you all this free service, all this free help, right? Ken and John and Ty and all of us, we this is what we live for. So we living for y'all. We need y'all to step up to the plate and make this a little bit easier for us. So with that, John, Ken, I'm done.
Crystal, thank you very much for both the knowledge and the wisdom. Great points. Excellent points. And I think it sounds like the all the participants appreciated it as well.
Good.
So just a quick thank you to everyone for joining and kind of persevering. You know, we know these are long sessions at the middle of a long day for everyone. But we're glad that you guys made the investment of your time and focus on hearing all the great knowledge that Crystal had to impart. For the people who have requested a copy of the recording of this webinar, that will be made available. I think everyone were posting requests in the chat. So if you haven't done so as of yet, please again, contact either Ty Umo or Daniel Leathers at the Urban League, and we can coordinate getting you access to the video. And aside from that, again, if there are no other questions, again, we'll thank everyone for participating in tonight's session, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Have a great night, everyone.
Good night, everyone. Bye-bye.